Celtic's league campaign of 1995-96 was one which will be remembered with mixed emotions by supporters. Having completed the term with a record points total and having conceded only one defeat, they were narrowly beaten by Rangers in the championship battle. However, the progress that has been made by the club has been astonishing. An accomplished team played a style of football that was nothing short of breathtaking. The disappointment of just failing to grasp a title was tempered by the knowledge that on and off the park, Celtic were again a force to be reckoned with. Preparations were made in July 95 for the season ahead. There was a real sense of anticipation among everyone at Celtic. The relief of returning to Celtic Park would be a major boost after a dismal season at Hampden. Manager Tommy Burns had made it clear that his objectives would not be realised overnight. However, he has been encouraged by the fact that more has been achieved than he could have hoped for in such a short period of time.
We've got back to winning games regularly, and they've also got back to playing a high standard of football regularly, and having a real genuine consistency about them, and getting the club a bit of stature back. That, I think, allied to the support that have been there to support us every game, especially here at Celtic Park. And I think there's certainly been a new buzz, for want of a better word, great atmosphere about the place. I think the supporters now look forward to coming and watching the team playing, because they're playing the way they want them to play. The players, after so many years of getting stick and abuse, suddenly realise what it is to be with a Celtic team that's winning and playing well and getting all the plaudits. And I think they're liking that, and you know, hopefully they need to take it to the next stage now, which is, you know, apart from winning plaudits, it's winning trophies.
As the players were put through their paces, much was expected of them. With the Scottish Cup and the trophy cabinet, minds were concentrated on the coming term. Pre-season warm-up matches with Newcastle and Liverpool had both been drawn. With battle about to commence, Burns had continued the gradual reshaping of his side, a process which would be ongoing throughout the season. John Hughes was drafted in from Falkirk in a dream move for the big stopper. But the signing of German international forward Andreas Thom for a record fee of £4 million had dominated the headlines. The first competitive game of the season provided the former Bayern Leverkusen player with a dream debut. It took only 33 minutes for Thom to pounce against Ayr United at Somerset Park in a Coca-Cola Cup tie. Andreas had quickly established a fruitful partnership with Pierre van Hooijdonk. 10 minutes into the second half, and the big Dutchman showed why he had instantly become a Celtic hero. Collins provided the pass, and Pierre provided the class to turn and score, putting Celtic 2-0. John Collins made it 3 from the spot, ensuring Celtic's place in the third round of the Coca-Cola Cup. The first league match of the season entailed a visit to Kirkcaldy for an enthusiastic travelling support. One of the now familiar rituals was that of the pre-match huddle, a new innovation which would be seen before the start of every match. It wasn't until near the end of the game that Celtic finally made a breakthrough.
A chance for Van der Eyck, Van Hooydonk! He scores! Celtic in front with just 11 and a half minutes left.
Celtic again faced Raith Rovers at the end of the month in the third round of the Coca-Cola Cup, beating them 2-1. The 10th anniversary of Jockstein's death was commemorated with a visit to Pittodrie. Celtic had not claimed a victory there since 1988, and after only a few minutes, looked unlikely to do so on this occasion.
It's a long goal! Tom Boyle is turned in, and Aberdeen take the lead.
That's a good play by Marshall. Barta to Donnelly. He's giving it away. Boom.
Into the space it goes for Jess. That's the second for Aberdeen. Simon Gorry holds his head in his hands as Ian Jess gets his first goal of the season.
The first game at Pittodrie at the beginning of the season, it was live on the television. Two goals down, I think I was captain for the day. Managed to get a couple of goals and we went on to win the game 3-2. I think it showed a lot of character to the team coming back.
Good running by Collins. A magnificent goal from Collins! Snell was beaten comprehensively and that was a stroke of a master.
Good play, is this Donnelly? Thomas nearly offside, he had gone offside. Donnelly's there, credit for holding the play up. Tom's cross! He scores!
A marvellous stroke of genius from Celtic!
Forced to hurry there by Tom. A measured pass for Donnelly. Van Hooydonk to Tom. Rebound and John Collins!
I think we made a statement that day of, you know, letting people see that we can go to grounds like Pittodrie. And, you know, we didn't even try to defend anything. We went to try and win the game. You know, indeed that game we were 2-0 down after maybe 8-10 minutes. And we could possibly have been in level terms because we missed a couple of chances. So we knew even though we were 2-0 down, we were playing the right way and that we would get goals. I think that was proved and it gave us a great kick-start to the season, if you like.
So Celtic getting a tremendous reception as they emerge for the first league game at the new Celtic Park. And there's the magnificent new stand. I'll just imagine we might have been sitting in canvas lang this afternoon, but I'm sure everyone here is quite happy.
Fans welcome club captain Paul McStay back to the side after recovering from a close season operation. Phil O'Donnell provided Celtic's goal against his old club in a 1-1 draw. It would be virtually his last contribution to the campaign until December due to injury.
The play goes down there by Peter Grant. Getting plenty of threat and aggression here. This is O'Donnell, he gets away from Martin. Oh, that's a marvellous goal by Phil O'Donnell against his former club. Oh, what a start by Celtic. They've carried the game from kick-off towards their opponents and they make the early breakthrough.
You know, it's always good to score against your old club, especially when the fans have been a bit stacked before it, but thoroughly enjoyed the start of the season as well. You know, it's playing a wee bit wider. Personally, I just want to play my team week in, week out, you know, injury free and, you know, feeling good.
Young Chris Hay was drafted into the squad in place of Andreas Thorn to face Hearts. But it was another young player, Brian McLaughlin, replacing John Collins, who made an impact.
He just loses out to Jimison. Touch there from Hughes, now it's Batter to McStay. Still it's McStay. That's a good save by the keeper, but a chance on for Celtic, and it's McLaughlin who scores. 5 minutes gone here at Tynecastle. Well, McStagan in the shot, and it broke away to McLaughlin, who picked his spot. And Celtic lead by a goal to nil. There's a goal scorer, McLaughlin, stabbing the ball through to Walker. McLaughlin again, looking very much in the mood this afternoon. Good play again! And it's another tremendous goal by McLaughlin. 8 minutes gone, he ran right through the Hearts defence. It's Hearts nil, Celtic 2. Jubilation among the Celtic players and the supporters. Cahoon topples as Boyd made the challenge, and no doubt this will be a tactic of Hearts in the second half to try and pressure Boyd, but here comes Celtic. It's Andy Walker running right through the defence, and it's another one for Celtic. Well, they've made the same kind of start for the second half as they did the first. 2.5 minutes of the second half gone. It's now Hearts nil, Celtic 3. It's Andy Walker.
Person who clears. Mata's header. And there's no offside flag here. It's Walker. And it's another one for Celtic. Andy Walker gets his second of the game. It's now Hearts nil, Celtic 4. Well, the Hearts defenders look over towards the linesman. There was no flag. Hearts players caught there. And Walker took the ball down and just lobbed it over Craig Nelson.
There was also disappointment for supporters with two defeats at the hands of Rangers, both at Parkhead. One in the Coca-Cola Cup and one in the league. The second of these came only 2 days after Celtic had beaten Dynamo Batumi to go through to the next stage of the Cup Winners' Cup. There was constant speculation about the future of midfielder John Collins, with transfer rumours which would persist until the end of the season.
Well, there's a lot of speculation. My contract's up in the summer. I have spoke to the manager, but nothing's guaranteed yet. But we'll continue talking until I hear differently. I'll remain a Celtic player.
The beginning of October saw a new face at Celtic Park, with the acquisition of Jackie McNamara. The promising youngster signed from Dunfermline for £600,000.
It was a bit nerve-wracking to start with. I thought maybe I'd play a couple of games and go into reserves, but I've seen I've kept my place, which is surprising and also good in a way.
Austin Grant. Donnelly. Now Van Hooydonk. That's it! The goal's been coming!
The manager's strengthened the team with quality players. I think his buys have come in and they haven't needed any time to settle at all. They came straight into the team, fitted in like a glove, and playing very well, all the signings. And on top of that, the players who were already there are playing very well as well. The whole team's playing with a lot of confidence.
It's Collins who strikes it. Well, that's a magnificent goal by John Collins. The perfect answer.
Despite dominating for most of the match, it wasn't until the 65th minute that Celtic took the lead.
But here's a chance now for Van Hooydonk. He must score! And Pierre Van Hooydonk, with a little help from Andreas Storm, gives Celtic the lead.
Celtic's hopes of drawing closer to leaders Rangers were dashed in the 83rd minute of the game, when Jackson converted a penalty to give Hibs a share of the points. Another opportunity to close the gap was lost when Celtic could only manage a draw at Kilmarnock. Nevertheless, Tommy Bond's side were playing magnificent football. Brian McLaughlin, having finally found the scoring touch, used it to good effect against the Dons. And a Van Hooydonk penalty ensured victory. A first leg of the Cup Winners' Cup clash with Paris Saint-Germain was beamed live into Celtic Park. Thousands watched as the Celts were defeated by one goal in Paris. In the return leg, the French aces scored three times without reply and ended Celtic's European ambitions for that season. Fans' favourite Tony Mowbray departed in October to join Ipswich in a £300,000 deal. One of the features of Celtic's play was a developing understanding between new signing Jackie McNamara and young Simon Donnelly on the right flank.
Simon and Sylvan done a lot of work afternoons with manager during the season, and it seemed to have paid off quite a lot. Simon's a really good player, and it's helped my game as well.
The young Scotland under-21 star had benefited from Burns's intuitive decision to change the role that Simon was asked to play.
Simon was put out there in the wide area at the start of the season, pre-season, because basically we wanted to see how he would do in that role. And again, being the type he is, you know, he listened, worked hard at the position, and he tried to learn as much as he could about it. And I think through doing that, he ended up one of our best players last season. And again, only 21 years old, so still a lot still to come for Simon Donnelly as well. But certainly his partnership with Jackie has been a real highlight and a real feature for the supporters here.
Bill the Gaffer had the young boys back most afternoons early on and midway through the season, working hard on movement off the ball and on the ball and passing and things like that, and that kind of worked out for us throughout the season. The season before last, obviously struggled goal scoring wise, but the gaffer had put us in a kind of deeper role playing wide on the right, so expectancy wasn't there to score as many goals, and luckily enough I managed to score I think 10 or 11 goals, so I was quite pleased with that.
John Collins sealed the points for the Celts at Firth Park in the dying minutes of the game with a classic strike.
That's mixed eight. Good run by Collins. Provides a cross, the chance is on for Van Hooydonk! Celtic make the breakthrough after 35 minutes.
Pierre's double strike against Thistle was the perfect answer to those who had questioned his abilities. 6 goals in 15 games had prompted some unwarranted criticism. However, he would want to prove himself a natural goal scorer. The game of the month, and probably of the season, came in the middle of November, when Celtic visited Ibrox for the first time that term. A crowd of 46,000 and a live TV audience of millions were treated to a classic encounter. Celtic had not been beaten at Ibrox since January 1993. With 4 points separating the sides, Tommy Burns' men were looking to make up some ground.
This is Tom. Andreas Tom's going to try one here. Oh, that is an incredible goal by Andreas Tom. What a mighty strike, an awesome strike. 9 minutes gone here at Ibrox Stadium. There's jubilation among the Celtic fans. A stunning goal by Andreas Tom, which gave Andy Gorham no chance at all. The gap opened up. It was obvious he was going to hit it. But my goodness, what a goal. His 7th of the season. That's Richard Goff. This is Gascoigne. Still it's Gascoigne forcing it through. Chance on here for Loudrup. Side of the box, Gascoigne strikes it in. Super Ollie does it again. It's a slap in by Boyd. Almost the way Solanke to win. He's got it again. Celtic with it all to do now. Josh McKinley gives the cross, it's Van Hooydonk, and that's in. Well, this is quite incredible. 3 goals apiece here at Ibrox. Van Hooydonk, putting his
entitled to think that if you go to Ibrox and score three goals, you're going to win the game. You know, so defensively, we've got to look at ourselves that day, and some of the goals we lost weren't what we're looking for. But as I say, I mean, these games can all change in, you know, one moment. You can go and score a goal and think everything's fine, and before you know where you are, you're two goals behind again. But as I say, it was a great game for both sets of supporters. I'll let everybody see that we're a lot closer to Rangers than what we were possibly 6 months or a year ago. And I think there was a statement made that day as well, that the fact that, you know, we're still undefeated in the 2 years we've been here at Ibrox. We've been there and we don't fear going there. I don't think, to be honest, Rangers fear coming here either.
John Collins made a piece of history for himself that month, with the first hat-trick of his senior career against Hearts and a 3-1 victory over the Edinburgh side. Celtic were attracting plaudits for a fluent and entertaining style of football which could rip opponents to shreds. Despite constant speculation about his future, Collins continued to provide a touch of class in the Celtic midfield with a tireless work rate and a cultured left foot. John Collins became the first Celt to net a hat-trick at Celtic Park since October 1988. December. In another incredible match with visitors Kilmarnock causing some anxiety among the Celtic ranks, Ali Mitchell scrambled the loose ball home to give Killie an early lead. After 23 minutes, things went from bad to worse when the Ayrshire men added to the lead to cause palpitations among the Celtic support.
Yeah, I think over the piece there was a lot of games we've actually maybe lost the first goal. But you know, it didn't detract the players or put them off in any way, because they knew the way that we wanted them to play. And they knew also that if they continue to play that way and have faith in that and in their own ability, then they would win the games. And I think they've done that more often than not.
The team's determination was awarded 2 minutes from the break when Andy Thom crossed for Peter Grant to finish and begin the Celtic fight back. Within a minute, it was all square. Determined play by McStay, an inch-perfect pass from Van Hooydonk, and a clinical finish by Thom meant that the players would be spared a half-time roasting from the manager. In the second half, Pierre finished off the job with a double strike which guaranteed victory against the side who caused problems for Celtic throughout the season. Celtic's determined fight-back had demonstrated a will to win and a passion which had been lacking in previous sides. A large part of the credit for Celtic's revival went to rejuvenated captain Paul McStay, who was rewarded for his loyalty to the club with a testimonial match. 15 years after he pulled on the hoop jersey for the first time, supporters paid tribute to their long-serving captain on the 12th of December.
It was a very emotional night. I think it's totally different, though, for all these people to turn up for Paul McStay on the night, but support the team as well. But it was sort of to show their appreciation of maybe what I've they helped to do at the club. You know, they've played a part in it for the last 14 years or whatever, and for them to turn up for Paul McStay, I must say it was hard to take in at the time.
In front of 37,000 supporters, Celtic defeated the English champions Manchester United 3-1. Young reserve keeper Stuart Kerr made his top team debut and didn't look out of place among the seniors. It was also a memorable night for Chris Hay, who added to the two Van Hooydonk goals to give the Celts victory. However, the night undoubtedly belonged to the maestro in what was an emotional occasion for Paul.
I don't think you'll find any dissenting voices within the Celtic support about Paul McStay. They love him. They probably feel they own him. He has been Celtic for a long number of years, and you only have to look at the reaction of the support for his testimonial match to see just how he's endeared himself to the Celtic fans over the years. He's going to be a big loss to them when he does finish. I think that's when we'll really appreciate just how good he was.
As he's got older, obviously, you know, trials have came to him and tribulations have came to him as a player. I mean, things have been going great. he was there, he was always the same. And things didn't go quite so well for him. Obviously, there was criticism there for him. But these are all things that are experienced in life. And sometimes when you live through that, you become a better person for it, you become a better footballer for it. And I think that's the case with Paul. And I feel now, at the age he's at now, maybe 30, 31 years old, he is really the person that would epitomise what a good Celtic footballer, a very good Celtic footballer should be. He's had a great career. He's had all that experience of 14, 15 years playing for a real top team, where there's no hiding place where he plays. He's always under the microscope. Everything's dissected and looked at, upside down, inside out, how's he played this week and everything. So it's a public trial every week for him and players of his stature. And he's lived through all that. And now I think you're looking at a marvellously mature footballer with, I feel, his prime years with him now and also still to come.
Burns continued to strengthen the squad, and in a £600,000 deal brought Danish international midfielder Morten Wieghorst from Dundee. He made his competitive debut in a 4-0 victory over Hibs. But it was another young star who grabbed the limelight with a spectacular opener.
That's Paul McStay. Jackie McNamara. Van Hooydonk. Donnelly. It's a good play by Celtic. McNamara! What a goal by Celtic! And Jackie McNamara! 11 minutes gone, and McNamara opens his Celtic account with great style. It was great support running by him. Superb build-up by Celtic. They showed a lot of patience. Simon Donnelly clipped it through, and then the first-time effort from McNamara over Jim Leighton. Hibernian 0, Celtic 1. Stay, looking to take charge of the situation. It's through now for Tom. It's Collins. There's Tom, good skills there, getting away from Milne. The chance is on here! Collins is calling for the ball on the far side. Is it through now for O'Donnell? Good movement off the ball by Celtic. In comes across, it's Van Hooydonk! And that's another superb goal! Hibernian 0, Celtic 3. It's Wieghorst who plays it through. It's 3 against 1 here. He certainly did run into trouble. It's through now for Simon Donnelly. Steadies himself! Number 4, with 5 minutes left here at Easter Road, Simon Donnelly makes it 4-0, and Jim Leighton there, picture of dejection. Storm through for Collins, good play by Collins, Van Hooydonk, and Celtic make the breakthrough.
Pierre's strike brought Celtic's tally to 15 goals in 5 games, before harsh winter weather forced the cancellation of the last two fixtures of the year. As 1995 drew to a close, Celtic lay second to Rangers in the table. During the enforced winter shutdown, with the first team concentrating on maintaining their fitness, Tommy Burns and the backroom staff turned their attention to the development of the stars of the future. Having already spent time at Ajax, they brought a top Dutch coach to Scotland.
Marvellous education. To see how they do it there, and also they were kind enough to let Heine Otto come over here for 3 or 4 days, which was a great experience for all our coaching staff, myself included, and just basically to learn, and you know, obviously to take how they do it, how they teach the kids, what they teach them, and why they teach them that.
I remember Tommy saying at the start of the season publicly that he was still learning as a manager, and I thought that was a great thing for him to say, because it meant we were all comfortable as well, that we've all got strong opinions of the game, and there is a rapport between everybody and opinions bounced off of each other, but there was an open-mindedness there as well. We know how we want to play the game, but we're also looking at other people, how they do it. Celtic traditionally had a great link with bringing through their own players, their own talent, and it went wayward there for a few years. We're starting to now produce players through the youth system into the reserve team and even into the fringes of the first team, which are a standard of what we expect at Celtic.
the most important thing, as far as I'm concerned, is the fact that we have to upgrade the training facilities in order to teach the young players. You know, for too many years the training facilities here have been totally inadequate, which is still the case. But I think now the board are suddenly realising that that's where the money's going to have to be spent, getting the facilities right in order to attract kids and also make sure you've got the right personnel there, the key personnel, which is very important, in order to teach the kids.
While Tommy Bonds kept an eye on the future, his immediate thoughts were occupied by the title race as the festive season approached and the season reached midpoint. Throughout the year, there have been a series of innovations off the park, including the launch of the Celtic Charity Fund, recalling the origins and traditions of the club. In a similar vein, in a month when a minute's silence was observed in memory of the victims of the Ibrox disaster, there was the launch of the Boys Against Bigotry campaign.
Well, Malky Mackay certainly hasn't looked out of place in this company. Donnelly doing well. There's no one really helping him to the left. Coming from a deeper position was the willing O'Donnell. McNamara outside him. O'Donnell goes for glory himself. Touched onto the post. Now it is Andreas Topp. Oh, Van Hooydonk! Later on the scene this time, didn't need to be there so early with Tom Boyd involved, but look at the progress that he's made. Oh, and that was Tom, and it stayed out.
An outstanding goalkeeping display by Andy Gorham was all that prevented Celtic from claiming victory over Rangers earlier in the year. The Celts continued their title bid with victories over Motherwell, Raith Rovers, Aberdeen and Hearts. Another outstanding goalkeeping performance, this time by Lekovic of Kilmarnock, and a goalless draw with the Ayrshire side denied Celtic the pole position as Rangers were beaten 3-0 by Hearts at Ibrox. At the end of January, Celtic sat only 1 point behind Rangers, having played the same number of games. Celtic faced Hibs at the start of the month, in a match packed with incident. In the first half, John Collins and Hibs keeper Jim Leighton were involved in a sickening clash of heads. The Hibs keeper was stretchered off for treatment, to be replaced for a spell by Darren Jackson in the absence of a substitute goalkeeper. It would prove to be a costly mistake for the Edinburgh side.
Replay ball, that this will be a danger. And there you see the goalkeeper fumble it. Van Hooydonk scores. 59 minutes gone, and Celtic get the equaliser. Finlay doing well to get in the cross. Once again, it's David Farrell who's here. It's returned by Grant. It's Paul McStay!
Celtic paraded new signing Georgi Kadeti in front of fans at Celtic Park to a tumultuous reception. However, problems over the Sporting Lisbon star's registration meant that it would be a further 6 weeks before the Portuguese international would be able to perform in a Celtic jersey. Celtic went on to chalk up another victory over struggling Partick Thistle, with Peter Grant, who is to be the next recipient of a testimonial, scoring the opener. Two Van Hooydonk goals and modern Vikos first strike for the Hoops sealed a convincing victory. Parting company with the club after failing to make any real impact in his second spell at Celtic was Andy Walker. He went to Sheffield United for a fee of £500,000. A convincing 4-0 victory over Hearts meant that Celtic had triumphed in all their meetings with the Edinburgh club that season. Tommy Burns had assembled a side which combined real determination with flair and skill. He had achieved much of what he had intended ahead of his anticipated schedule.
Keep that in my mind, all over the pitch, so that we know that, and for the front players in particular, we've always got to be together. Always close to one another, no 70 yards away from one another. Once we get into the last third, then we've got to come alive. Come here first time, be on to the second one, first one turns and plays it in. And we can do that as we're playing. But think about that, the third one. Okay, come on.
The group of players we've got, I think they came through many sort of stages and phases that would possibly normally have taken maybe 3-4 years to do that. I think they've come through that in 1 year. You know, it says a great deal about them.
I mean, there's a high-profile signings. Andrews Tom was a club record. Pierre Van Hooydonk, they cost significant amounts of money. But I think if you look at the job that John Hughes, Tosh McKinley have done as well, it's not always about the £1 million or the £2 million player. The real trick in football management is getting value for money. And I don't think Tom has made a bad signing.
The likes of Tosh McKinley, he's been a wonderful signing for us. John Hughes, again, you know, both players at 30 years old, we gave an opportunity to come and be pool players, basically, for Celtic. No giving them any guarantees in any shape or form. Basically just sent them come, and if you're in and you're playing well, you'll get an opportunity. If not, then you know that there's a big squad and it's Celtic, it's no Hearts or it's no Falkirk, it's a big club, and see what you can do. And the two of them have grasped it with both hands and been outstanding.
For Tosh McKinley, at the age of 30, his longed-for move to Celtic had also earned him his first call-up for the national squad.
when you are a Celtic supporter, then it's obviously the pinnacle of your career to come and play in the Celtic first team. I did get that opportunity. It's probably when it comes late in your career that you do appreciate it more. But it helps when you come and play with the caliber of players like Paul McStain, John Collins. If you're in a bit of trouble, all you need to do is give the guys a ball and they get you out of trouble.
There was a Young Player of the Year award that season for another signing.
And Jackie McNamara was a young player that we brought and we thought to ourselves, well, he'll maybe play 25 games for us. But again, we're only really thinking of him as being a regular player. But again, the exact same thing happened. He goes in there and McNamara just get better and better as the season went on.
St Patrick's Day was the appointed time for a crucial encounter with league leaders Rangers at Ibrox. Only 3 points separated the sides at the top of the table. Sending off of Jackie McNamara meant that a 10-man Celtic had to battle to keep their championship hopes alive. With supporters urging them on, the game went into the closing stages with Celtic piling on the pressure.
They're queuing up to be the hero and to draw Celtic back into this game. And it's a good header and it's in for Hughes! A dramatic equaliser for Celtic!
I think that we've been in a position where, so early, as I say, you know, we're only here 2 years, I think we've been in a position so early where the Old Firm games would be so critical. So I feel we've caught up very, very quickly on them. It's at a stage now where Old Firm games are back to what they could, well, what they were maybe 15, 20 years ago, where, you know, if one beats the other, there's a chance they'll win the league because of that. So I think we've made up, you know, good ground on them as far as that's concerned. I think in the games we played them, certainly, maybe six games, I think there was maybe three, most definitely three, possibly even four that we should have won. So in the games against Old Firm, I think there's very little to choose, to be honest with you, because I think we matched them more often than not, played very well against them. I think, if anything, we'd possibly maybe change our tactics slightly against them and possibly do that in the years ahead. And I think that's an important thing for our players as well, that we don't want to become a team that plays one system. Otherwise teams can make things difficult for you. It's important to be able to adapt to change. So we'll be concentrating a lot on that with the players this year as well, so that we don't just become a one system team.
Perhaps the real achievement of the Celtic manager has been to take a group of talented individuals with different personalities and fuse them together as a unit in such a short space of time. He has managed to combine shrewd signings with homegrown talent. The team consists of young players and those who draw upon a wealth of experience. In addition, foreign players have immediately become an integral part of the setup.
Nice one.
An important element in combining such talents is to create a team spirit, which is a quality which has been evident in this Celtic side throughout the season.
That's maybe why the consistency has been there this year and that will to win. The spirit's come through because there is a good atmosphere in the dressing room. Usually you'll find that if there's a good atmosphere in the dressing room, well, we can take it out into the park and we'll all be fighting for each other. I'm playing with a lot of confidence this year, so it's we're looking for this. You see the part's worked up, isn't it?
A great bunch of boys, great spirit in the club, and I think that's what's maybe got as much success as we've had so far. I mean, people talk about the double winning team and whatever in 88. I think this is a better football team, you know, and I thoroughly enjoy being part of it. And it's great to see so many young boys coming in, you know, and doing exceptionally well, more than whatever they can have been thought of been doing, you know. And they've been set great standards for themselves, and they can only get better.
Enjoying every minute of it. It's been great 6 months for me personally. It's a good bunch of lads, good to get involved with. Unbelievable start for us to be involved and playing regular. It's some surprise to me.
Well, it's great playing alongside guys like Paul and Peter and stuff like that. They give you their experience in the game and help you along. Especially when I broke into the team a couple of years ago, they helped us a lot. And now there's a few youngsters coming in as well, so we've got a good mix. So it's going well.
The team played very fine, very good. And it was very difficult for me in the first 3.5 months because I lived there in the hotel together with my wife and the kids. Then we found a house and now we settled down and everything is fine. And I think the atmosphere, especially the atmosphere from the supporters and the partnership between the supporters and the players are very well. And it's a great feeling when you come in the stadium and you see everything is green and white. It is very, very nice, very good.
Supporters responded to the team's performance on the park by backing them in huge numbers. Throughout the season, attendances soared.
Our average ended up just under 35,000, which was close to our capacity. We added more seats during the season back in December, which turned out to be quite popular, even though we're not covered seating, and we had over 2,000 season ticket holders there, who are now, as we look forward, taking advantage of that and turning those into permanent seating, reserve seats for the coming season.
Work has continued on the stadium throughout the close season, and with the construction of the new south and southeast stands, there will be an additional 13,000 seats.
We're looking forward to having a bigger capacity. We'll have 47,500 seats here, all excellent seats, and within that capacity, I would say about probably close to 80% season ticket holders. Not only that, but you realise that the people who are sitting in each seat all have an excellent view of the playing surface now. I would say superior to just about any other football park. So I think the enjoyment of the spectator has been added to just by having a better stadium.
The transfer of Giorgi Chedetti was finally concluded, much to the delight of supporters. The 27-year-old striker, a former Portuguese Player of the Year and a proven goalscorer at both club and international level, was short of match fitness for the April Fool's Day clash with Aberdeen.
Here's Tosh McKinley now, who provides like another good cross! And Celtic take the lead! Simon Donnelly! With 2 minutes played, the perfect start for Celtic. This could be an opening up as well, it's Van Hooydonk. And it's a goal for Celtic, Pierre Van Hooydonk. McKinley. What a match he's having. Boyd plays it through. Simon Donnelly. Oh, a stunning goal. A stunning goal by Simon Donnelly. And a great build-up by Celtic. Well, just listen to the welcome. Giorgi Chedetti. Andreas Thom is the man leaving the field. And it just gives you an indication of the quality now coming into Scottish football. The German international leaves the field and on comes the Portuguese international. Michael Watts. And Hoydonk's there.
their fans plenty to cheer about tonight. Certainly in post-match analysis, you can look at that Aberdeen defence, but Celtic are really going about the job here. Goal difference could be crucial. Here's the new boy coming through.
Just such a fluent performance. I think there are demands in this club to play a certain way. It's not just about winning, you have to win with some kind of style. And this is a very, very stylish side, good to watch. And it's a side that I think is worthy of the support, and that hasn't always been the case in recent seasons.
There was disappointment for supporters in the Scottish Cup semi-final. A late Van Hooydonk goal wasn't enough to cancel out goals from McCoist and Laudrup. And Rangers went on to lift the trophy, beating Hearts in the final.
Other than the 3-each game at Ibrox, when Rangers made it a very open contest, Rangers have tended to play nice and tight at the back, offer Celtic a bit of room and space away in midfield and in their own defensive areas. But immediately they got anywhere near that 18-yard line, Rangers started to kill the game. And basically Rangers have won those competitions through having a stout defence and the ability to go and hit Celtic on the break. And at the end of the day, I think in football, over a season it all levels itself out and you get what you're entitled to. And really they haven't done enough as yet to prove that they're going to knock Rangers off the pedestal.
Celtic had another chance to close the gap in the league when they faced Kilmarnock, but yet again Killie caused problems. As the news filtered through that Hearts were beating Rangers at Tynecastle, Celtic pressed for an equaliser. It eventually came from Pierre Van Hooydonk, who pounced to score with a sensational strike. However, time ran out and Celtic dropped 2 points. Van Hooydonk was leading the scoring charts by a mile, and against Hibs, the big Dutchman struck a double to take his total to 30 for the season. Pierre had proven himself to be an outstanding signing by Tommy Bonds.
Desperately seeking a second goal, here's Andy Tom, he's onside. Van Hooydonk into this, must be the second for Celtic. It is! Pierre Van Hooydonk surely now has won the game for Celtic.
Well, I think Van Hooydonk's just a goals machine, to be honest with you. I think he's just the type of lad that'll always score goals. And provided we've got the players here that can, you know, get the balls into the box, give them the right type of service, then he'll be a goal scorer of the highest order, you know, as far as we're concerned.
His goal scoring partner Andreas Thom is also an example of Burns's astute dealings in the international transfer market.
Well, I think he's more a provider of goals, influences the team well, he's a very intelligent player. And looks to, you know, get in behind defences and set up chances for other players. But I think him and Pierre, you know, I think their partnership worked very well for us this year, for a long time. It made a difference in games, you know, Andy would do something special or Pierre would get us a goal or whatever. So they too have made a big impact on our team this year. And I think the arrival of Kadetti the last couple of months of the season, we gave him maybe 4 weeks to get himself into decent fitness before we put him in for a full game. And I think had we been able to get him in there fit right away, then he would possibly have changed things a wee bit for us and maybe got us more points. Maybe not, but you know, in saying that, it's something we've looked at closely, because the last 3 games of the season that he played, we scored 4 goals in each game. and he was very influential in that.
The last game of the season saw a 4-0 victory over Raith. Despite a record points total, Rangers claimed their eighth title in succession. Nonetheless, the players were given a tumultuous standing ovation by the 37,500 crowd.
And if I look back over it and see that we're going to be drawing 10, 11 games, which ultimately cost us dearly. But I think if you look at the amount of games we've won, we've only lost one game. Celtic Park for their 36th league game campaign, we've lost one game. It's quite remarkable to think you didn't win the league in that. But you know, the standards have been set. The players know that they've come in there, that they've set standards. I think coming back to our own home certainly made a big difference to us, because I think clubs now fear coming here, especially the stadium the way it is now, and when it's jam-packed full of Celtic supporters and Celtic are playing well and get a goal, then the whole thing lifts everybody. So that's something that we've got right back on our side as well, and I think it's something we want to add to and enjoy for the years to come.
I'm not a football responded well to the efforts made by the players, and it was a good season from a performance standpoint in terms of playing. I think to finish the league with only losing one game and probably very few setbacks in the whole programme we went through is a very positive thing. Now naturally we're a bit disappointed it didn't turn into silverware, but I think the message is pretty clear that the club has come forward quite a bit.
Evidence of that progress has been ticket sales for the new season. Around 37,000 supporters have purchased season tickets so far, adding greatly to the income generated by the club.
Well, the first most important item for revenue I think is the ticket sales and the season ticket revenues. And they're the bedrock on which the club bases its other income. And they all come from success and an attractive product. And that is a combination of good players, good results, good facilities, and a good attitude and a good service to the supporter who buys tickets. So those elements all go into that product to start with. There are six revenue-producing parts to the club. One, of course, is the ticket sales. Another is the merchandise and retail and catalogue. We try to trade upon the Celtic brand name, which gives us, I think, a very big advantage over other clubs in producing revenues. Next one is our catering and hospitality operation here with the restaurants and the match day services and food and so on. Then we have our publishing, which is the Celtic View and programs and videos and so forth. That's important for revenue and for communications to the supporters. And we have our corporate services, which provides benefits to business buyers, such as advertising, corporate boxes, of course, broadcasting, television rights, licensing, and other income sources. And last but not least, there's our Celtic Pools operation, which is the biggest in the UK, and helps the club enormously by providing extra revenue, mainly for the stadium development, of course, but I think in general terms, we have to make sure that the revenue is going ahead as our costs go ahead. As we attract big-time expensive players, we have to have all these sources working for us to make sure the club is taken to, as we all want it to another level.
As training began for the new season, there was no doubting the commitment to that cause. The aim is to claim the league flag, and in the process prevent Rangers equaling Celtic's record of 9 titles in a row. To this end, Tommy Burns has broken the club transfer record once again, spending over £5 million to bring a highly rated player from the English Premiership.
Well, we brought Alan Stubbs, who's basically a very good football, great passer of the ball, and able to, you know, draw teams on his and then go from defence to attack very quickly. And he's got very good vision on the ball, you know, very able to step into the middle of the park, link up with midfield players. So we're looking forward to seeing him playing. Plus he can be aggressive as well when he's going to win the ball. He's got a bit of stature about him as well. Good experienced player.
The ex-Bolton Wanderers skipper has signed a 5-year contract with the club.
It's all a new challenge for me. Everything's going to be new to me this year. And that was maybe one of the reasons why I wanted to go, because I'd been at Bolton for 8 years and I needed something new, and this is it. So I'm really looking forward to it. I knew it was a big club, but when I seen the stadium, I thought the stadium was absolutely fantastic. And it's not even done yet. So looking at the stadium just speaks volumes for the club. It's a really impressive place, and I think when it's finished, it'll be the best in the country, to be honest.
Burns' other major signing of the close season was that of AC Milan's Paolo Di Canio for over £3 million, which will go a long way towards easing the disappointment of the departure of John Collins to Monaco.
You know, a player of great technical ability, and something that possibly we've lacked in were a locker, if you like, and the fact that when teams leave us with the ball and go way back into their own penalty box and try and condense the game into maybe 30 yards, it makes it difficult no matter how well you pass the ball if ultimately you come up against a sea of opposition shots. So then when that happens, you need somebody that can take the ball and create and beat people and unlock that, if you like, and I would see him doing that type of role for us.
As anticipation for the season ahead grows and the team prepare for the new campaign, supporters can reflect on how far the club has come in such a short time and the part that they have played in turning the club around.
You know, 3-4 years ago, you're sitting looking at a situation where it was basically despair. And now, 2 years down the road, you've got a stadium that's going to be packed. Everybody's clamouring for season tickets. You know, so they're showing their support to Celtic Football Club, not only in their voices, but in, you know, their hard cash as well. They're prepared to come and pay in order that we can go and bring in quality players. Because you know, it's the supporters that's paying for all these things. It's the supporters that's paying for the stadium. It's the supporters that's paying for the top quality players we're bringing in, and they're going and they're showing that support, and I think we'll get maybe something like 37,000 season ticket holders. Perfect example, really, because they're going and they're showing exactly why they're supporting the club and how they're supporting the club.
My message is, it's great to have you here. You're here for one purpose, and that's for you. And your demands and your aspirations are exactly the same as mine. So on a personal level, as a supporter as well as being a director and a principal owner of the club, I'm as anxious as you are for success and can't wait for the season to start.
Well, our hopes are to improve in every facet and every aspect of our team, you know, both as an attacking force and as a defensive team as well, working on all these different things, because there's great expectations of us. I've got great expectations of the team, of the club, where I want to take them to. Or help to take them to. So for that point of view in football, there's never a case where you think, well, it's just another season, we'll get ourselves this or that. It's a question of going and giving everything we can when we're training, taking it into the games, continually exciting our supporters, giving them good things to talk about, and basically just taking the club on another stage further. We'll be right back.
coming to get ya. Spitting out lyrics, homie, I want ya. I came to get down, I came